Hello everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you are located in the world. Today, I'm going to talk about Ballerina, the open source cloud native programming language, more specifically about its next version, Swanwave. I am Imesh Sudhasingha, currently working on the Ballerina project at WSO2. I'm also a member of the Apache Software Foundation. Let's talk what's Ballerina in simple terms. Ballerina is an open source programming language built for the cloud to make it easier to use, combine, and create network services. Before moving on, let's have a look at a little bit of history on Ballerina. Work on Ballerina programming language started in 2016, and the language was created by WSO2, and the first stable release was done in 2019, which was 1.0. And we presented that version at Open Source Summit Japan last year as well. The next major version of the language is named Swan Lake, and it's a complete revamp compared to its predecessor. And we have made a lot of use of built-in improvements and reliability improvements. We are planning to make it generally available in quarter one next year. And right now, beta versions are available, and beta 4 is the latest version available. During this presentation, first I'll be talking about why we decided to develop Ballerina, and then I'll take you through a tour around Ballerina's capabilities. Then we'll look at the roadmap and what to look forward to, and finally how to learn Ballerina, how to interact with the community and the ecosystem. Let's start with why we decided to develop Ballerina. To answer that, let's consider this. How is it like to develop software for the cloud nowadays? Suppose your organization has several teams developing several microservices and you have to develop a new microservice. Most probably your microservice or your new API that you're going to develop will depend on third-party APIs or services or APIs provided by other teams or in your same organization. That means writing code today means integrating or using capabilities provided by other services and APIs. And once you are done writing the code, the next step is to build and package into Docker. Once that's done, the next phase will be to the deployment. You will have a different environment like prod, pre-prod and dev like that, and you will have to write deployment descriptors, be it Kubernetes or servlet, and then you will have to deploy that into those clusters. Once you have done with the deployment, the next phase will be the scaling. Sometimes those two, deployment descriptors, deployment and scaling, both go hand in hand, but the scaling part is the next fact that we have to consider. When the load varies, your service should scale horizontally accordingly. Then you will have to think about managing access when other teams or other external parties rely on your API. When they start using your APIs, security aspects and access control involved. Then the next one will be continuously monitoring. Due to the distributed nature, you will have to have a full view of what's going on with your service at the operational level. And at the same time, you need analytics to have a understanding of to get business insights and for growth hacking aspects. So as you can see, developing software for the cloud era involves a lot. It's not just writing code. Works with different areas. You had to consider a lot of factors, and these are not limited to the ones that we talked about. For example, we have concepts like dual factor app, then fallacies of distributed computing, different protocols, networking primitives and security best practices, different deployment technologies like Kubernetes and serverless. That way, the cloud native ecosystem or writing code for the cloud has become more and more complex. This made us think How much time do you spend on non-functional recurring tasks in this name of cloud nativeness? And how much time do you spend gaining expertise in cloud technologies? That's when we thought of Ballerina. That's how we got the idea of Ballerina. Then you may wonder, what's the problem with existing programming languages or libraries and frameworks? First of all, that's good. It's a good way to keep on going, but we saw few fundamental issues. First, almost all the popular programming languages treat network as an IO resource, but in Ballerina, we treat the network as an inherent part of the language. And when talking about the cloud nativeness of existing programming languages, they have been repurposed with libraries and frameworks. So when you are to achieve true cloud nativeness, you will have to use a stack of different libraries. Not that a library or a framework is another level of abstraction that's provided on top of the abstraction provided by the programming language. What will happen if you want to go beyond the scope of the framework? Then at that point, you will no longer be in the comfortness of the framework. People usually go with libraries and frameworks because they are familiar with the underlying programming language. Considering all those facts, we thought of Duolingo Ballerina, and when talking about Ballerina, instead of repurposing existing technologies, Ballerina addressed them from the first principles. And Ballerina is zero leakage. That means anything can program with Ballerina, and everything that's in code is usual. Ballerina has a good low code aspect. We will see in the remainder of the presentation that part as well. And Ballerina abstracts the network interactions and saves the developers from fallacies of distributed computing. The most important thing is Ballerina let developers to focus on value addition into their business domain. Due to these reasons, we think Ballerina is an ideal candidate to be the programming language for the cloud era. To get more understanding, let's take a deep dive and have a look at what features, capabilities Ballerina offers. First of all, before starting on that, to set up Ballerina, you will need to install, you will have to download the Ballerina installers from the website. You can visit our download page and download the installer matching your platform, be it Windows, Linux, or Mac OS, or if required, you can build it from a zip. You can download it as a zip or build from the source as well. And once you have installed Ballerina, you can verify if the installation was successful using a command like bell version. And the next one that comes to our mind is the IDE tooling. For that, Ballerina has a feature-rich VS Code plugin, and you can download it from the VS Code marketplace. Let me show that to you. So in the VS Code marketplace, when you search for Ballerina, let me search. The first one that comes up is the Ballerina VS Code plugin. You will see a deprecated Ballerina plugin, which was for the Ballerina 1.x versions. And this, the one that we are using, is a new one and targeting the Swan Lake release. Download and install that one. I have already downloaded that. And before getting our hands dirty, let's discuss a bit about how Ballerina looks like as an overview. So Ballerina is a flexibility type language, and it's reliable and maintainable. Ballerina is statically typed so that type compatibilities are validated at the compile time, and it's structural. So Ballerina compares the shapes of types instead of the names to determine subtypes. And Ballerina has explicit error handling, and Ballerina is concurrent safe, and it has a familiar and intuitive syntax. You will see that while we are doing the demo. In the upcoming slides, let's move on. Ballerina is open by default. That means Ballerina tries to be conservative in what we are sending and be liberal in what we are accepting. This, to demonstrate that, this is an example. This is a closed record named product. And if you look at that, it has fields called name, description, price, and currency. These are required fields. And it has a field name ID, which is an optional field. And then it has a REST field, which is of type JSON. That means a product should have name, description, price, and currency, and optionally have an ID. And there can be other fields which are subtypes of JSON, like int, float, string, and JSON itself, like that. You will see them in action in the upcoming demo. And Ballerina is data-oriented. Ballerina has a rich language-integrated SQL-like query syntax, which you can use to query list tables and streams. Yes, Ballerina has streams and tables. Stream is a good way to process events or process large amounts of data without worrying about the memory limitations. And table syntax is to represent a table, that means a collection of records, where a table has a key, and a key can be a simple or a complex one. And if we take this query example, we have a products list, and we are querying for the products which has a price higher than 50, and the currency is USD. And at the same time, we are converting the price of the product into GBP by applying a conversion ratio, and then returning a new set of products whose currencies are in GBP. So you can use these language integrated queries in interesting ways and intuitive ways, because SQL-like clauses are familiar to us. We have the from clause, from, let, limit, order by, where, those clauses, and select clause, like that. And Ballerina is concurrent. Ballerina has a concept called strands, which are lightweight threads. And Ballerina has workers, which are the realization. That means workers are the ones that are going to spawn strands. And you can use futures in Ballerina to run functions synchronously. This is an example of using strands and workers. So here we have two workers, worker one and worker two. And you can see that worker one and worker two are passing messages across them using these arrow icons, arrow symbols. They are called send actions. And at the end, the main strand or the function is waiting for both worker one and worker two to finish. A thread in Ballerina can have multiple strands, and only one strand belonging to a given thread can run at a given time. So it's cooperatively multitasking. Yeah, this is just how to run a function synchronously. You get a future and you can wait for the future to complete and do something else as well. And the other interesting thing about concurrency in Ballerina is asynchronous IO. Ballerina has a concept called remote methods. And when you are invoking a remote method, Ballerina runtime makes sure the call is non-blocking. But I'll demonstrate that during the demo as well. And this is really useful when you are handling a large number of connections and you don't have to use explicit callbacks or listeners to handle the asynchronous behavior. The other aspect is Ballerina is graphical. Ballerina has a graphical representation using flowcharts and sequence diagrams, and it's leak-free. That means anything you code in Ballerina language can be visualized, and vice versa. It has a really good low-code aspect, which you can which is good for non-technical people or less technical people to understand code logic or to do coding in low code programming as well. And this is a simple example of such flowchart of a method. Now let's move on to the most important part of Ballerina. That's the cloud nativeness. let's get our heads dirty for this. Let's build a simple currency conversion service which will behave like this. So this is the request that we will be sending at the end. So it will have two path parameters. One is the base currency, the other one is the target currency and an amount. So what this means is the amount is in USD right now and we want to convert that to GBP. And in this program, we will be using an external service to get the exchange rates and do the conversion. Now let's go to VS Code. Okay. I have already created the Bellrina project, and this is my Bellrina project. As you see, the Bellrina project has this Bellrina toml, which is the main configuration file, which specifies the package name and things like that, and also the dependencies. And main.bell is the one that was generated automatically, and .bell is the extension of a Bellrina source file. And let's write our service. Now, in Bellrina, I said that network and primitives are inbuilt to the language itself. So Bellrina has a concept called services, listeners, and clients. So in our case, what we are going to write is an HTTP service, specifically HTTP REST API, and it will have a GET method. To represent that, in Bellrina, we can simply write a service on an HTTP listener, like this. And we are going to listen on port number 8080. What we created here is a service, the HTTP service, because our listener is an HTTP listener and port is 8080. The listener is the one that's going to interact between the network and the service, and listener will be taking the messages coming in through the network and passing them to the service and to the resource methods. A service has a set of resource methods, and in our case it will be a GET method, a GET HTTP method. And note that our request will be convert slash then path parameters and a query parameter. We can write this in Bellrina like this. So our context path is slash, we gave it here, and from this point onward our request path is convert. Then we have our first path parameter, which is base currency, and then we have the second path parameter, which is the target currency, and we have a query parameter, which is a float for the amount, and this will return a float. Float will be the return one, will be the converted value. Okay. And within this resource function, we have to invoke an external API to get the exchange rate. For that, I'm going to use this API. And to invoke that, we have to create the HTTP client. I'm going to name it DCC client, since this is like dynamic currency conversion. And you have to specify the base path of the, when you're creating the client. And yeah, okay, we create the client, and now we have to invoke the external service. To do that, we are going to send a GET request, and this is how we are going to send the GET request in Bellrina. And yes, you can see this is the remote function call. This is the remote function invocation in Bellrina. I'll like talk about that later as well. And we need to pass the base currency here to get the conversion rates. And to do that, I'm going to use the string templates in Bellrina, and so that I can pass the base currency as a parameter like this. Yeah, just like this. And now we need to get the response. I'm going to get the response as a JSON like this. And note that Bellrina has inbuilt support for JSON and XML, And here we are directly accessing the response as a JSON. And note that in Ballerina, you have to handle errors explicitly. So here, what it reports is, it says, since this remote API call can fail, it says it will return either a JSON or an error. So if there was an error, we will use the check keyword to check that. And if there was an error, this will simply return the error. And to symbolize that, we will have to say this will return an error or float. And let's log the response that we are getting first. And let's say response. And when you are logging, you can use key value pairs like this. And okay, so we created this, the basic implementation, where we simply for now, let's return 0 here. And yes, let's run this program and see what's the response that we are getting. So based on that, we can do a lot of improvements to our service. I'm going to open another terminal and get our curl command ready. Yeah. I'm going to send a request to convert $100 to GBP. And okay. Amount. Okay, there's a typo here. Let's rerun the service. Okay. It logged the response, and let's take it out and see how it looks like. This is the response, the exchange rates response that we are getting. And here, when formatted, you can see it returns a success boolean base, the currency code of the base currency and the rates, which is a map, and each key is the currency code, and in front of them are the exchange rates. Let's represent this in Ballerina using a record. I'm going to create a record called conversion response, and which will be an open record. I'll tell you why. And we know that there will be a boolean called success, and there'll be a string called base, and a map of floats called rates. And instead of JSON, now we are going to say we will be receiving a conversion response. Now, this is where the open by default principle comes into play. So in this response, we saw it has a lot of fields, but what we are interested in is the rates and whether the request was successful or not. And the base currency code, we can omit that as well if required. And by having an open record, what we are saying is this is what we expect, and if there are other fields, that's fine, you can have them, but what you're saying is these are the ones that we're interested in. And since now we have the response, we have to check if the response was successful, and if it wasn't, we will have to return an error. If it wasn't successful, we will have to return an error saying exchange rates could be obtained. And if it was successful, we know that the rates contain our target currency, which is GBP. And this will return an optional float because this key can be in the map or not. And let's say right. In Ballerina, you will have to handle errors explicitly, and it's null set. So because of that, we get an optional float, and here we will have to check if rate is not there or rate is empty. If it's empty, that means we couldn't get the the exchange rate for the target currency, and we will be printing that. And we will add the target currency as a parameter to here as well, so that when the, if the error was logged, it will be printed as well. And from this point onwards, after this checking, Balduna compiler knows that rate is a float, so that we don't have to do any casting, and Balduna compiler itself does the tightener on it. And we just have to return the rate for the rate multiplied by the amount. So this will be the converted rate. And I think we did the implementation. Let's add the log line here for us to see what's going on. An info log, converting currency, and base currency is like this. So as you can see, when logging, you can use key value pairs, which is really helpful when you are doing log analysis using, say, Logstash or an Elastic Stack. And the target currency and the amount. Okay. And now what we have to do is, let's just run this and see how it looks like now. And let's send our request. And as expected, we got somewhere around 75. 100 USD is converted to GBP is 75, around 75 GBP. And similarly, we can try another currency. So, say Singapore dollars. It's 136 Singapore dollars. And like that, and it's logging our request. And right now we have done the implementation. And probably, yes, we can do morphologizing to the service, to the resource method, by adding response codes. There's a really nice way of doing that. I'll just do that here. You can say that it will be written in an HTTP OK. And then you can return it like this, and the amount like this, and yeah, something like that. This HTTP OK is an inbuilt record, and instead of returning just an error, you can do something like return bad request and HTTP internal serve error, like that. So as you can see, this syntax is very intuitive. It says we have a get method like this, and it accepts base currency and target currency as path parameters, and it has a query parameter, and it will return an HTTP OK, bad request, or internal server, like that. But I'm not going to go deep into that part, and I'll be reverting back. And the next part is, we have created our code. And the next part is building and packaging it into Docker, and also writing deployment descriptors. For that, Balduna has, you can create the Docker image using bal build -- cloud equals Docker. With this one, it will be just creating the Docker image. But in our case, we want the Docker image plus the Kubernetes deployment descriptors. And for that, I'm going to use -- cloud k8s. And with that, it will output the Kubernetes deployment descriptors as well. While it's running in the background, I'll demonstrate one more thing. Actually, I want to demonstrate two more things. First one is, once we have written this service like this, you can generate the OpenAPI specification using bal OpenAPI and give the source file where you have the service, and it will output the OpenAPI specification. And you can share that OpenAPI specification with external parties, so they can generate clients and connect to your service easily. Okay, the OpenAPI specification was generated, and this is that. This is our request path, and we have the base currency and target currency as required path parameters. And then we have a query parameter called amount, and it's required as well. And as responses, we have 200, okay, and 500. Yeah. So if you had user defined types here instead of float, it'll have those schemas in the OpenAPI specification as well. And okay, in the meantime, our Bell build was successful, and it prints out the command to run to deploy your the generated deployment generated artifact to a Kubernetes cluster, and also it prints out the command to expose your deployment through your Kubernetes cluster as well. I'm not going to demonstrate that due to the time limitations, but let's have a look at the Kubernetes deployment descriptor. And if you look at that, you can see that you have a service, and then you have the deployment, and in the deployment you have the memory limits and the port. Note that these memory limits were configured in the cloud.toml file, and I had done that previously, and you can use the cloud.toml file to specify the container image name, tag, and those stuff as well. You can do more fine-tuning with the cloud.toml as well. And finally, it has a horizontal autoscaler for you to scale. Okay, now we are almost done with our deployment. With our writing our service, now we are left with the observability part. And before that, I'm going to show one more thing. That's the configurables in Ballerina. In Ballerina, you have configurable variables. We will want the port to be configurable. So for such cases, you can create a configurable variable like this and pass that into the program using a config.toml file. And here we can simply say the port is this. And this config.toml can be passed during the runtime or can be mounted to your Docker image like that. So that flexibility is there, and you don't have to use environment variables anymore. And yeah. Now let's go move on to the observability aspects. Ballerina is fully observable with, you can mount a metrics with Grafana and Prometheus out of the box. And you can do distributed tracing with OpenTelemetry, and we are using Giega as the OpenTelemetry implementation, compatible implementation. And then you can do log analysis using ELK by feeding Ballerina logs to your to Logstash or to Logstash directly to the Docker logging driver as well. And if we are to enable observability to this this service, we simply have to add two input. One is the Jaeger import and the Jaeger for tracing, and then Prometheus for metrics, and then we will have to enable metrics like this in the config.toml. And this is optional. And using the config.toml, you can specify the Jaeger host and ports and those stuff as well. And we have enabled observability for Ballerina. And in the Ballerina toml, we specify observability included true. That's by default true. And once we are done, we just have to run this. And for this to send metrics, we need Jaeger and Prometheus running. And to do that, I already have a Docker Compose deployment prepared to create the Jaeger, Grafana, and Prometheus instances. And I'm going to start that as well. Yeah, with that, I'm going to start Prometheus, Grafana, and OpenTelemetry, this Jaeger with that. And okay, those services are up. And let's go and look at, let's first send the request and go and look at Jaeger. So I just send this this GD request and another one. Let's send the same request again. And let's go and look at the traces in Jaeger. Okay. So our service is belonging to the context path slash, and our operation, we are interested in the get method for currency conversion, and let's find the traces. Yeah, as expected, there are traces for two requests, and this is the first one. As you can see, it comes to the resource method and to the, it goes to the HTTP client, and then it goes out to the external service, and that's the call that has taken most time. And yeah, and this, it's going to the external service like this. And let's go back and see the next request. And there's an interesting observation that the time taken for the second one is real low. And that's because the client we are using is caching the response, and it's returning a cached response instead of sending the request to the actual external endpoint. And that's for the tracing. You can, Belluna can trace across multiple services, and I chose a very simple demonstration today. The next part is with Prometheus, with metrics. And for that, let's go to Grafana and let's log in and skip this one. And let's add Prometheus as the data source. And yeah, and let's test. Yeah, it's successful. The next thing is we have to import the Belluna dashboard, and Belluna has a Grafana dashboard already available in the Grafana marketplace, and its ID is 5841. These are documented in the Belluna website, well documented. And I'm going to import this dashboard, and along with that, we have to specify the data source. It will be Prometheus, and here we go. We got the full view of the our system right now. The uptime and the throughput, number of requests we have sent 3 so far, and the top 5 services. The first one is the metrics endpoint that's used by Grafana or Prometheus, and these are our services. And remote services, this is the remote endpoint that you are invoking. And like the, let's send a request in the meantime. Several requests, and let's wait for this to update as well. Yeah, the count went to 5 as expected, and yeah. You can monitor status codes, errors, and stuff with this. And you can explore more through the Belluna website. And let's move on with the presentation. And the, there's one last thing that I need to mention. Actually, two. One is this asynchronous remote method call. This call is non-blocking. Even though it looks like it's blocking call, it's non-blocking, and it's really useful for when handling a lot of active connections. And the other one is the Belluna low code view. And let me open the Belluna low code view for this. And I'm going to open the low code view for our get resource. And at the same time, I'm going to open the Belluna sort side by side. And here, as you can see, this is our service, and this is the low code diagram corresponding to our resource function. And yeah, let me zoom it like this. And it's a, it shows that we are sending a request to the external client, BCC client, using sequence diagrams. And we have flow charts here, the flow control, and like that. This is really good for non-technical people and to less technical people to do programming itself or to understand code like that. And with that, I think I demonstrated almost all the things that I wanted to show with Valrhona. And note that we covered almost all the aspects regarding related to developing coding for the cloud, from writing code to building Docker and Kubernetes images to scaling to observability. And next, let's move on with our presentation. So we discussed these past listener services, and Valrhona has support for protocols like HTTP, HTTP2, NATS, gRPC, WebSup. You can look them up in the Valrhona website. You can write REST APIs, GraphQL APIs, or gRPC APIs easily. We saw the Open API tool. Valrhona HTTP client support failover, load balancing, resiliency, retry, those aspects as well. We saw how we can use configurables in Valrhona code. And we saw XML and JSON being available as types in the language. And we saw how the response was converted seamlessly to our user-defined type. And here, as in this example, you can navigate XML through syntax as well. Talking about security in Valrhona, we have O2, JWT, and basic code inbuilt, and SSL and authorization aspects. Just to give you a sneak peek, if you wanted to protect this using with JWT, you just have to add this annotation on top of them. And in this one, we are protecting this service using an external authorization server and using JWT. And you can even protect individual resource functions with like this, and you can access control based on scopes for different resource functions differently based on a custom claim if required, like that. And yes, let's move on. We talked about the core to cloud aspect, and Valrhona has function as a service aspect as well, which I don't have time to demonstrate, but Valrhona has inbuilt support for AWS Lambda and AWS Azure functions. And this is how you could write an AWS Lambda function. You just have to add the AWS Lambda annotation on top of a function, and you will get the AWS Lambda context and the payload. Similarly, this is an similar Azure function, but this is doing the same thing that we did in our service that we wrote. This is to convert from one currency to another, given the amount, and it's calling the same API. And the interesting part is, once you have written the function, when you build it, it'll output the zip files that you need to upload to Azure or AWS. Observability aspect, we talked about that. And for CI/CD, Valrhona has Valrhona GitHub Action, which you can use to get a development environment up and running within your workflows. And overall, as we have talked a lot of about Valrhona's capabilities, we can say Valrhona is a batteries included platform. It comes with the package management, a good, really good standard library, and a test framework and ID supporting and a structured documentation and like that. Talk about Valrhona roadmap. Right now, what we have is JValrhona. That means we compile Valrhona to an intermediate representation called Valrhona Intermediate Representation, or BIR. And then we generate bytecode and runs on JVM as of now. There's a parallel work going on to develop a native compiler to compile Valrhona Intermediate Representation into native code. And that's in Valrhona. With that in mind, Swan Lake is the next major version of JValrhona. And as I said, we are planning to make it generally available in quarter 1 2022. And Nutcracker will be the release after that's expected in 2022. And we are hoping to release the native compiler, Valrhona compiler, by 2024, because it's a lot of work and a great milestone. And talking about Valrhona community, Wellrina has a really good community, helpful, very interactive. You can join our Slack channel and ask questions in the user channel, and you can ask questions in Stack Overflow as well. And you can visit our Wellrina platform or GitHub organization and star our repositories or report issues if you find any. And you can attend community calls. We hold community calls every month. And there's a meetup group for called Wellrina user group as well. You can join them. And you can follow the Wellrina Twitter handle to get updates, continuous updates on Wellrina. And finally, to learn more about Wellrina, the best place will be to, the best starting point will be the Wellrina website. And there you have a lot of pointers. There's this learn page where it has a separate guide for to learn by examples or language walkthroughs. And apart from that, we have a Wellrina tech blog, which is maintained by the community on Medium. And we have Wellrina Central, which is the place where you can push packages for others to be available. And with that, we are coming to the end of our presentation. And I hope within the limited time, I could give you some reasonable idea about the capabilities of Wellrina. And I invite you to look further into Wellrina and, if required, get help from the community, as I mentioned. And to summarize what I discussed, Wellrina is trying to address achieve true cloud nativeness from the first principles instead of repurposing the existing technologies. And Wellrina is flexible type, concurrent, data-oriented, and cloud native, reliable, maintainable, and graphical. So talking about cloud native, I said that we have network primitives inbuilt, and we saw how services and listeners are used, and we saw the low-code view for the graphical aspect, and I couldn't show you, but using the low-code data, you can edit the code as well, so, simultaneously. And well, we saw how open by default policy is operating with open records and how seamless it was to get responses and use those responses when calling external endpoints. And Wellrina abstracts network interactions and saves developers from the falling into fallacies of the distributed computing. And let developers focus more on implementing value-added features for their core business domain. And finally, as we showed, Wellrina is a batteries included platform, which comes with a lot of package management tool, testing framework, good IDE support, good documentation, a rich standard library like that. And thank you for following me through this presentation. I hope that I could give you some understanding about Wellrina. And if you have any further questions, you can ask them now. And I invite you to also have a look at Wellrina after this presentation as well. And yeah, let's move on with questions if you have any. And thank you for following the presentation.